Tonight, we tell you the one about the Irishman. This one's a swashbuckling go-getter whose mix of blarney, bonhomie and the drive to win could have taken him to the top of any profession. One of his early ambitions was to become a priest, but he didn't. When he left school, he worked behind the counter in a rural Irish bank, but he left. And now he's a success in one of the world's most exciting jobs. A good mate of his is singer Chris Rea, and according to Chris, our man is a bit of a rocker.
That's right, Michael. He's made music with the likes of George Harrison, Mike Rutherford of Genesis, and he was even on stage 2 weeks ago playing the drums with Boyzone.
Thank you, Chris. Well, although he plays the drums and is nifty with a pair of spoons, music is not his day job. Right now he's on stage at the Theatre Royal, Drury Lane, but he's not a dancer. Great crack. But here's the thing. As the boss of one of the top Grand Prix racing teams, he's here to unveil the car that he hopes will win the Formula One championships this year. Let's join the roadshow.
Stay there for a few more pictures.
I'm sorry to interrupt the spectacle, but it's a great day for the Irish, and I am here indeed to say, Eddie Jordan, this is your life.
Whoever is responsible is instantly sacked.
Well, here is the lineup so far, friends and colleagues from motor racing. Your engine supplier, Hiroshi Honda. Driver, Jarno Trulli. From your family, your mother, Eileen, your sister, Helen, and brother-in-law, Neil. And the woman who shared all the drama of life in the fast lane for the past 21 years with your children, Zoe, Mickey, Zach, and Kyle, your wife, Marie. Now, Marie, Eddie's been described as a whirlwind. Is that how you see him?
Well, I think life has been a bit of a whirlwind. Even when things were bad or we had no money, things went at a fair pace.
Well, Eddie Jordan, this is your life. For 30 years, first as a driver, then as the owner of a team, you've enlivened motor racing. Since 1991, you've flourished in the high-risk, big-money world of Formula One, while more than a dozen other teams have gone under. You weren't born chewing a silver spoon. In fact, at one time, you sold salmon on the streets of Dublin to fund your sporting ambitions. But you've built up a highly respected organisation. It's been a long struggle to become a serious challenger for the Grand Prix title, but you've done it all with a smile on your face.
Eddie's the current Formula Atlantic champion, which in fact means he's the top driver in Ireland.
I've learned how to endure very severe amounts of pain.
One veteran of the game has tracked all your triumphs and disasters and has some extremely well-chosen words to offer on the subject, the voice of Formula One, Murray Walker.
Eddie, I've always said you were a superstar, and my goodness, I was right. You know, we go back a long way. I remember talking about you when you were racing in Formula Ford, right up to when you had a test for Formula One, and not everybody knows that. But now you're one of the top team owners. And why? Because you've got this brilliant gift for wheeling and dealing. And you've got this lovable Irish charm where you metaphorically and actually put your arms around people and make them like you. And we all do that because you've brought fun and life and excitement and charisma to Formula One. Jordan is a great, great team to be associated with, and you can be very, very proud of it. This year, I think you could go right to the top. I know it's going to be an absolute cracker of a party. If you've got anything to do with it, enjoy.
And in a work hard, play hard business, your racetrack parties are legendary. Well, you've busked with the best, and here are a few of the mates you've rocked with. Singer Chris Rea, from Mike and the Mechanics' Mike Rutherford, and Pink Floyd's Nick Mason. Now, Chris, do you think that Eddie could have been a pop impresario? Oh,
please.
Well, for about 3 months in 1993, he was having a tough year. He convinced me that it would be good for my career if I did a concert in Monte Carlo. And when I got there, I found out he'd done a deal with Marlborough that he got a table at the gig.
Now, Mike, before now, it's been Mike and the Mechanics plus Eddie.
Yeah, well, you might think that Eddie, you know, in the rock and roll world, which is not his world, would be a slightly quieter version, but I can promise you, having had him on stage in Dublin when he joined us, he just took over the place, played a great set, and we dubbed him the next Keith Moon.
Wow. Nick, what do you say?
I think he has all the characteristics of a great rock drummer. I mean, he speeds up, he drops his sticks, drinks a lot.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, all in all, just only a little better than I am, I think.
Well, praise indeed. Thank you all very much. Well, back to the starting grid. Edmund Patrick Jordan, you were born at the Wentworth Nursing Home in Dublin on March the 30th, 1948. Your late father, Paddy, was an accountant for the Electricity Board, and your first family home was in Beechwood Avenue in the Ranelagh district of Dublin. Now, Eileen, when Eddie was 10 months old, he became very ill.
He was very ill indeed, very sickly. He had a Pink's disease, which was a disease of the liver. And we were advised to move out to Bray for fresh air and all the rest. I was advised to take him out of Woolens and put him into cotton in the month of May, which I thought very strongly against, but I did, and he improved.
Well, there you are on the mend, back home in Dublin. Very sweet. Now, when you were four, you went to St Anne's Preschool in Milltown. 3 years later, you started the Sing Street School in Dublin. It was run by the Christian Brothers, who have a reputation for ruling with a rod of iron. How tough was it, Eddie?
Well, overall, it was very tough. Your predecessor, the great Eamon Andrews, went there as well, and indeed Gay Byrne. It seemed to be like a foster home for people going into the television business. But the state education in Ireland was quite sensational at the time, and they made a great personality change in people, and they made them go out to life and look after themselves. So the education was generally very high.
And you spent 11 years at Sing Street School.
And that's, Eddie, when we learned to be streetwise.
You haven't seen him for 30 years, Aidan Boland. So, Aidan, we're talking about school days. Did it make men of you?
Well, I have always had the greatest respect to the Christian Brothers since, as Eddie says, the mixed gathering was cool, but it did teach me how to get into the television business, and here I am. But
thank you.
We used to walk to school and save our bus fares. But we used to have to walk to a couple of places like Mount Pleasant, Sherilman Street, which were tough places. And that's where we all learned the phrase of when to stand up and when to run.
Happy days. Aidan, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, your education must have made an impression on you, because when you were 15, I read, you considered becoming a priest. How serious were you?
When you've spent a lifetime in a place like Sing Street School with the Christian Brothers, there was not much option. You always considered it. In my case, I didn't consider it all that long, but it was there, there's no doubt.
Well, you leave school at 18 with no clear idea of what you want to do. Your mother suggests you become a dentist, like your grandfather, but instead you take a 6 weeks accountancy course at Dublin's College of Commerce before getting a job with the Bank of Ireland. Your first posting is to the branch at Mullingar in West Meath, but Helen, he left her a vital piece of equipment at home.
He did. Mum was very anxious that he should be warm in bed at night, and she had this hot water bottle. And she got a friend to that was going to Mullingar to deliver it into the bank, much to Eddie's disgust and the delight of all the girls, I can tell you. He had a long while trying to live that down.
Lost your bottle, eh?
In more ways than one.
Well, after 4 years in Mullingar, you moved back to the Dublin branch in Camden Street, where to this day people certainly remember you.
And the reason is, Eddie, because you're always into devilment.
You used to give her a lift to work, Margaret Finnan. So, Margaret, Eddie wasn't everyone's idea of a bank clerk.
Well, back then we didn't have too many telephone lines, you know, but there was at least one of them was always occupied by Eddie, running his sideline business, you know, the second-hand car trade, you know. Even when sometimes somebody looking for a car loan, he might try and sell them one of his. You know. Sometimes succeeded, too.
Well, thank you very much, Margaret. Yeah. Now, the race driving starts by sheer coincidence. In 1970, there's a bank strike in Dublin, so you spend the summer in Jersey, working for the island's electricity company, and making extra money working in a bar. In Jersey, you discover the little go-kart track at St. Brellard's. You're instantly hooked, and when you get back to Dublin, you buy yourself a 100cc kart. By 1972, you've become an Irish national karting champion. Within 2 years, you graduate to Formula Ford 1600, and that season you record your first victories with the unpaid help of a team of dedicated pals. And they've flown in from Ireland to be here. Jim Woods, Marty McCarthy, Michael Tunney, Liam Nevin and David Meek. Ooh. So, Jim, you were all with Eddie in the pits.
Oh, indeed. Yeah, the catchphrase in those days was, get out the spanners, Woody. And there was never enough power, never enough handling and never enough sponsorship.
That's absolutely right.
And Martin, to raise the money for racing, Eddie ran a business called Curbside Motors, which sounds suitably dodgy.
Well, it was certainly inappropriate anyway as a name, Michael. Yeah, Eddie was spending about 4 or 5 times his annual bank salary on motor racing at that stage, and a lot of it was funded by buying and selling cars. But he also developed an art for escaping from tight situations. And one of those I remember very distinctly was we were coming home from Mondello Park one Sunday night, racing off to Barry Kavanagh's pub. And, of course, the car wasn't quite 100% legal. Tax was a little bit out of date, etc., etc. Next minute, the policeman beside us waves us down. So we sit in the car, Eddie gets out, talks to the policeman for a few minutes, and then he comes back and says, Eddie, are we in trouble? Are we going to jail? Or what's the score? He says, no, Martin, not at all. He says, your man's coming around taking the car on Tuesday. So he was a good man to escape from tight situations.
Yes, there's a lot more where that came from, I'm sure. Thank
Absolutely.
You very much. In 1975, you move up a category to race in Formula 3, but in an accident at Mallory Park in England, you shatter your left leg and spend most of the following year getting fit again. By now, you're an assistant bank manager, but you're still making money out of hours. Now, former Grand Prix driver Martin Donnelly, you've seen Eddie in Super Sales Overdrive.
That's right, Michael. I think it was back in 75, it was on the way to Mondello Park in Ireland. It's a local race circuit. And to travel there, you go on the Nace dual carriageway. And my father was driving at the time, and he says, look, he says, I could swear, he says, that's Eddie Jordan. And I looked up, and there's the bull DJ selling offcuts of rugs at the back of this Volkswagen pickup.
Well, the highlights of 1977 for you are winning three Formula Atlantic races in Ireland and meeting your wife. In 1978, you clinched the Irish Formula Atlantic Championship in a Chevron B29. In January the following year, you and Marie get married at St. Joseph's Church in Terenure. Your old mate, Des Large, is best man, and you weren't exactly loaded when the newlyweds moved to England. Marie helps family finances by taking a job as a packer in a Northampton factory, earning £40 a week. You have some success in Formula 3 and Formula 2. One of the fresh faces in Formula 3 then was an ambitious Brummie called Nigel Mansell. And your old rival is on our screens tonight.
Hi, Eddie. I think he's nobbled you, hasn't he? Couldn't happen to a nicer person. I'd like to single out one thing, Michael, about Eddie, and that is he's so personable. He's the only man I know, and I've actually driven and raced for a lot of teams and different nationalities, but he can express one word better than anybody. And because it's family television, I'm not going to tell you what that word is. Honestly, Eddie, you're a fantastic guy, and I wish you all the success for the future. Those world championships are just round the corner, and you keep motivating your drivers like you do, because only you can do that. There's few people in the pit lane can do that. And I sincerely, from the Mansell family, wish you all the best for the future. Have a fabulous night.
Thank you, Michael. Well, you get as far as testing a Formula One car for McLaren, but you realise that as a driver you've come to a crossroads. Your old friend Big D, Derek McMahon, backs your decision to form your own racing team. So in 1980, at the age of 32, you establish Eddie Jordan Racing from a lock-up unit at Silverstone. How hard was it to give up the driving?
I didn't think I was ever good enough, so it wasn't that big a chore. If I had more talent or if I had more years in the bag, I probably would have persisted. But at that time, I could see, I had this dream in my mind that I'm going to be too old to be a champion if I ever get to Formula One, but I could be the youngest team owner in Formula One, and that was sort of the, if you like, the magnetism towards running a team. I also felt that having run Big D's team from the commercial side and from the fiscal side, I felt maybe I was better in that area. And from my experience of dealing in cars and such things, that I had a natural given talent in that particular area more so than the driving, so it was an easy decision, really.
Yep. Marie, when Eddie set up on his own, money was still very short.
Yes, we were down in Monaco, staying in a caravan with Zoe, our eldest, who was about 8 months at the time. We took one of the local team managers in Formula 3 to babysit, and we had no running water or anything, or hot water, so we went off down to the beach with our glad rags, and we swam and then showered under the showers on the beach. And I changed into my Oxfam dress, and I don't remember quite what Eddie had on, and we went off to the ball.
Well, recognition comes in 1983 when your car is involved in an epic struggle with an emergent Ayrton Senna to finish second in the British Formula 3 Championship. 5 years after that, you pick up your first Formula 3 title. The man behind the wheel in that championship year went on to drive in Formula 1. A word now from Johnny Herbert with another of your famous Jordan old boys, Eddie Irvine.
Hi there, Eddie.
Hi, Eddie.
My memory, obviously, of those years is making you, because at the end of the day, winning that championship set you off into that wonderful future you had through the 3000 and into, obviously, into Formula One.
I'd like to thank you, Eddie, for selling me my first Formula One drive in the most uncompetitive car in Formula One, and then selling me to Ferrari. I was your biggest sponsor, I remember, so I probably made you as well in later years after you sorted me out. But anyway, we've had some great times, and I'm sure we'll have some great times in the future. Anyway, enjoy your night and see you soon.
Sooner than you think. Since recording that message, he rearranged his busy schedule and he's flown in from Italy to be here. World Championship runner-up, Eddie Irvine. Cool. Do you have anything to add to that tribute?
Actually, EJ probably doesn't realise this, but the first time I actually seen him was, it was either Brands Hatch, he was doing the Grand Prix support race in Formula 3, it was Brands Hatch or Silverstone, I can't remember, it was the last corner, there was a big right-hander and he crashed right in front of me.
And he got out of the car and he made the appropriate hand signal for his performance that day. I don't know if you remember it or not, but it's not watershed yet, so we have to leave that one out.
I can't believe you got him to shut up in such a short space of time.
Very much. In 1989, you go on to win the International Formula 3000 Championship with the French driver, Jean Alesi. A year later, you're planning the big break into Formula One. One of your heroes tests the first Jordan Formula One car on a very damp Silverstone track in November 1990.
And it was a very emotional moment for both of us.
He achieved 5 Grand Prix victories and was runner-up in the Formula One Championship, John Watson. John, like the weather, Irish eyes were slightly damp that morning.
They were, and it was a very important moment for Eddie, and it was for me as well, because the first time the Jordan car turned out on the track, all Eddie's aspirations and ambitions all hung on really how that first drive went. And I came in with a smile on my face, and I think that said an awful lot. The car was good, and in fact, they went on to take 5th place in the championship that year. But it took until 1998 for that first Grand Prix victory to come, and then, of course, 2 last year. And now, with 2 drivers hopefully going to score points for you in this year's championship, well, the championship is there for you and for the team to win, Eddie.
Thanks, John. I wish I shared your optimism, but well done.
I know you do.
You're a star.
Nicely said. Thank you, Mike. Jordan Grand Prix does well in its first season in Formula One. But in the first 6 months of owning a team, your major sponsor moves, your chief driver, Bertrand Gachot, goes to jail for assaulting a taxi driver, and your replacement driver, the brilliant Michael Schumacher, is poached by the Benetton team after just 1 race for you. Not quite the luck of the Irish.
It was like everything was tumbling down in front of me. Every obstacle that I could possibly think of seemed to be there. But the great thing was that we had a very good car. So the atmosphere and the commitment and the passion was always there, so I always felt we could pull through.
Well, I don't mean to rub it in, but just for the terms of history, your debts from that first year amounted to £4.5 million, and you go into the 1992 season with a flawed engine, and in 16 races, you score just 1 point. Now, Ian Phillips, as commercial director of Jordan, prospects look bleak.
Yes, they were some of the darkest days, I think, that any of us could ever remember, but Eddie's optimism, which we've heard an awful lot about, carried us all through. I mean, he's an inspiration to all of us. And he's at his best, at his fighting best, when he's got his back against the wall.
Well, Team Jordan eventually make the big breakthrough with a victory at Spa in Belgium and an historic 1-2 finish for Damon Hill and Ralf Schumacher in 1998. Last year, Heinz-Harald Frentzen followed up with wins at Manucourt and Monza. They were champagne moments.
Frentzen win in France. Heinz-Harald Frentzen wins at Monza in Italy. Another magnificent victory for Jordan. And there is the ecstatic Eddie Jordan.
After today's launch, your number one driver, Heinz-Harald Frentzen, had to head back to Monaco. But before he left, he sent you this message.
My message to you is just that I'm very happy that I have driven for you last year and I'm driving for you this year. I'm very proud of being a member of the Jordan team. I have to say thank you very much. Everything you've done to me, that I got the possibility to drive for you.
Well, as we've heard, the pressures of running a successful Grand Prix outfit are intense, to say the least, but you remain, first and foremost, a family man. Your wife and children have always been your anchor, and they regularly travel with you to the races. Mickey, what's your plan for the future?
Well, at the moment, I'm doing my A-levels, but I hope to go into PR and maybe end up working with Dan.
And Kyle, what are you going to do?
I'd like to take over my dad's job and call it KJ Racing.
When do you plan to do that? This month? Next?
When he dies off.
Thanks, Carl. Thanks, sir.
I'll bear that in mind. Give me a little bit of notice, will you?
The Jordan pit lane attracts champions from many other sports. Some of those legends who form an exclusive Eddie Jordan fan club have turned out for you tonight. From the world of golf, Ryder Cup players Darren Clarke and Lee Westwood. From football, Irish international and manager of Leeds United, David O'Leary. And from National Hunt Racing, Britain's most successful jump jockey, Richard Dunwoody.
Congratulations.
Richard, you have actually ridden one of Eddie's racehorses.
I have, as well. His cars are a little bit more successful than his horses. I think it was Manor Farm Crumpet or something.
Please don't remind me.
A long time ago.
I'm not
David, what do you and Eddie talk about when you meet?
Well, I bore him, really. I'm an F1 nut. He don't want to hear about F1 when he's relaxing and... I think the second part is I tried to change the football team he supports, really. So
I'm a Coventry fan and he's a Leeds fan, and we'll leave it at that.
It's healthy, we'll leave it at that.
Right. Lee, how is Eddie's golf?
I think it's fair to say he swings nearly as fast as his cars. but I think he probably makes a better watcher than he does a player, but I think he's working on it a bit.
I don't know how the team managed to get any points anyway. I think he spends more time at Sunningdale practicing there than I do, so...
You can go now, lads.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Now, somebody mentioned party more than once, and I think that we ought to end this tribute with a bit of a knees up.
His name is Eddie Jordan, as Dublin as you please.
It's a school friend who sang at your wedding. He's flown in from Florida to be with you tonight,
Brian
Red Hurley.
Gah.
His game is racing motor cars. Their skin is black and gold. And every time they win a race, it takes away my soul.
We've got the backing music from Liam McConnor and John Sanders, and Red has tuned your spoons.
Yes,
so, OK, lads,
we just happen to
play
have
your hearts
cue.
Out. Thank
Here you.
You
are, sir.
Tonight, this is your life.
On BBC Two, the tide's turning against the evil Stairpike. Murder and mayhem in the concluding part of Mervyn Peake's Gormenghast in just a moment.